Hey there, this is the key for the Unify progress check, the free response questions. All right, so there's two questions that we have to work with here. So the first one, we have this balanced equation right up here. All right. Now it says this delta H. So delta H is something that we learned in unit six, but with this negative right here, it means that it's exothermic. All right, that's important for what we're doing here. So this is exothermic. That means energy is going to be released. That means the energy of the products is going to be lower than the energy of the reactants. So when we go down here, we want to draw, it says it has an incomplete energy diagram for the reaction, and the potential energy of the reactants is listed right here. So we go to letter A. It says carefully complete the energy diagram by drawing a curve that accurately shows the progress of the reaction, beginning at the reactants, moving through the transition state, and ending at the final products. When adding the products to the diagram, be sure to use an energy level that is appropriate relative to the energy level of the reactants. So I have that over here. So being that this is an exothermic reaction, we want the energy level of the products to be lower. So this is where our products is going are going to be. Okay. And then we want to show the transition state through here. So we're going to go through the activation energy through the transition state at the top of that activation energy hill to the products. Okay. So this is what the drawing should look like for letter A. Okay. Where we're going uphill through the transition state and then down to where we have the products that are a lower energy level than where the reactants are. Okay, so that was letter A. Then letter B, on your energy diagram, draw a dash curve to show the reaction progress from reactants to products in the presence of a suitable catalyst for the reaction. Okay, so going back to this diagram, if this is our uncatalyzed reaction, so we want to draw a catalyzed reaction. The starting and ending point are the same, but the pathway to get there requires less energy. So just we have to draw the height of that activation energy hill somewhere lower than where we started initially. Okay? So something like this. So the dashed line, that would be our catalyzed reaction. Okay, then letter C. On your energy diagram, draw a vertical line segment with a length that corresponds to the activation energy for the reverse uncatalyzed reaction. Okay, so the activation energy is going to be from, in the forward reaction, is going to be from the height of the reactants to the top of this activation energy barrier. Now, if we're talking about the reverse reaction, then it's going to be from the level of our products to the top of that activation energy barrier. Okay, so this right here, this would be our activation energy, that vertical line segment, that would be the activation energy for the reverse reaction. Okay, all right, so that's the first one. Going to the second question. Okay, so now we're dealing with this equation right here, okay? And this is the same reaction that we had in the rate of reaction lab that we did. So for letter A, we want to write the balanced net ionic equation for the reaction between magnesium and hydrochloric acid. Now this is kind of a throwback to some of the earlier units. So with this, I'll just type this out here. So we have magnesium, and then what happens is this hydrochloric acid is aqueous and the magnesium chloride is aqueous. So that means these are both going to be separated into ions, all right? So the chloride ion is considered a spectator, so it's not changing from reactant to product. The magnesium ion is changing. It's going from this neutral solid to the magnesium positive 2 ion. And the hydrogen ion is changing into hydrogen gas. So those are changing, but the chloride is not. So that means we eliminate chlorine from the reaction. So it's going to look like this. Just type this out. So these are the two hydrogen ions. There's our arrow. And then we have the magnesium ion on the product side. And then H2 gas. Okay. So that's our net ionic equation. Again, we just got rid of the spectator ion, which was the chloride ion. Okay, now letter B. The student collects a hydrogen gas by the reaction, and this is a lab that we did back in the day, and it measures the volume over water at 298 Kelvin. After carefully equalizing the water levels inside and outside the gas collection tube, as shown in the diagram below, the volume is measured to be 45.6 milliliters. The atmospheric pressure in the lab is measured at 765 torr, and the equilibrium vapor pressure is 24. Okay. All right, so now for part one here, we want to find the pressure inside the tube due to the hydrogen. Okay, so we want to find the pressure inside the tube due to the hydrogen. Okay, so going over here. So the gases in the tube are going to be the hydrogen gas that was produced, but plus the water vapor, because we're in the presence of water. So, and because the water level inside the tube and outside the tube are equal, we can set that equal to the barometric pressure. So the barometric pressure is going to be equal to the pressure inside, which is going to be the sum of the pressure of the hydrogen gas and the pressure of the water vapor. Okay, H2O. Sorry, that's kind of sloppy. So the barometric pressure is equal to the pressure of the hydrogen gas and the pressure of the water, which is inside the tube. So the pressure inside the tube is equal to the pressure outside the tube. Okay, now we're given the values here. So now we can just subtract. It would be the barometric pressure, which is listed as our atmospheric pressure. Same thing. It's going to be 765 torr. And we're going to subtract from that the water vapor pressure, so that's 24 torr. So 765 minus 24 is going to be 741 torr. So that's our pressure for the hydrogen gas. 741 torr. Okay. All right, so that's that one. So the next question, part two, we want to find the number of moles of H2 produced in this reaction. Okay, so with this, we know the pressure of the hydrogen gas. We know the volume of the hydrogen gas. We know the temperature. Now we can use the ideal gas law to solve for the number of moles, N. Okay, so going back to this Jamboard here. So this is the ideal gas law, Pivner. We want to solve for N, the number of moles, okay? So we know all these other values. We know the pressure of the gas in the tube is 741 torr. We know the volume of the gas in the tube. There's a measurement right here. It's 46.4 milliliters. For the ideal gas law, we want to have that in liters, so it's going to be 0.046. Oh, I'm sorry. 45.6, not 46.4. So it's 0.0456 liters. The value for R, since the units of pressure is in torr, the value for R from the green equation sheet is going to be 62.36. And the units for that are liters, torr, over moles, and Kelvin. And then the temperature, going back to the problem, it was 298 Kelvin. So 298 Kelvin. So that's the setup right there. Okay, so then plugging all that in, we get a final value of 0.00182. moles. Okay, 0.00182 moles. Okay, going back to the next problem, letter C. It says in a different experiment, a student places a piece of pure barium in water containing 250 milliliters of 6.44 molar HCl and observes that the rate of appearance of hydrogen bubbles when barium was added was much faster than the rate of appearance of bubbles when magnesium was added. The student claims that the greater reactivity is due to the difference in ionization energy between magnesium and barium. So explain the difference in ionization energy between magnesium and barium in terms of atomic structure. Okay, so magnesium and barium are in the same column, or same group on the periodic table. So when you're explaining differences in group trends, we want to use the idea of shielding effect. So barium is a larger atom. It has more energy levels of electrons. So the outer electrons will be shielded from the nucleus by the core electrons. So that makes the ionization energy much weaker for barium than it is for magnesium. So it reacts much easier. Another way to look at it is those outer electrons are much easier to remove in the barium than they are to magnesium. So it's going to react at a faster rate. It's going to react easier. It'll take less energy. Okay. The next one, HCl can be produced in this exothermic reaction, H2 plus 2ICl, 2HCl plus I2. Here's the proposed mechanism. Okay. So we want to write a rate law for the overall reaction that is consistent with the proposed mechanism. So when we write out the rate law for a mechanism, we want to look at the rate determining step. So step one is a slow step, and we want to look at the reactants in that slow step. So this is just going to be rate equals K. And then there's just one of each of those reactants. So it's going to be the concentration of H2 to the first order times the concentration of ICl. Also to the first order, there's just one of each. Okay, so that's the rate law right there. And then we have another incomplete energy diagram. Okay, so we want to write the relative activation energy for the two elementary steps. We want to finish this off, and we want to write show the enthalpy change for the overall reaction. Okay, all right, so this it's an exothermic reaction, so the products will be lower. And step one is the slower step. That means this step is going to have a higher activation energy. So this is how we show that. Let's see this one right here. Okay, so it's an exothermic reaction, so we know the products are going to be lower. And the first step is slower, so that's going to have the higher activation energy. So it should look something like that, okay? Showing that this is two steps. The first step is a slower step, so it has a higher activation energy. So this is your first step, this is your second step. Then the products have to be lower than the reactants. So this is what that's going to look like. And that's it for this one. Go back to the answer there. Okay, that's all for that. Have a great day.